Beautifully eased through the offside this time. No effort at all from Richie Richardson.
Certainly Richie Richardson's timing seems so casual and yet so effective.
Another splendid boundary for Richardson. One more run added to end the mayhem at 424 for 4. Terrific performance from the West Indies there. Their big chance of winning was to do precisely what they did there today. Lara showed the way with that wonderful innings of 179. I was very impressed with Campbell once again. He's a good cricketer, made 89. Kenny Benjamin did a job for them as night watchman, made 20 and stayed there for over an hour. And Richie Richardson unbeaten on 87. And I should think absolutely delighted. He planned the tactics well. They wouldn't have gone out there and done what they did without him saying, go for it. And it worked very, very well indeed for the West Indies. The bowling figures, well, they're reflected in that batting score. Malcolm, 24 overs, 4 maidens, 2 for 95, and dropped that caught and bowled off Carl Hooper. Doesn't seem to be very good on caught and bowled, Stephen Malcolm. Fraser, 1 for 111 off 29. Watkinson had 50 taken from 12 and was harshly dealt with. Cork, 70 from 18. Wasn't very well today, not only has he got that strained groin muscle, but he's also got a virus, and he did well to get through 18 overs for Michael Atherton. Gallien had 49 taken from 10, including 19 from 1, and Hick had 38 taken from 10 overs also. West Indies only 30 runs behind. I reckon Richardson was setting them to be around about 60 behind at the close of play. Well, they exceeded that, and it was a very good effort. The close of the third day, 454 for England, West Indies 424 for 4. There's still plenty of cricket to be played.
The path of medical.
Test match cricket now on BBC One. Highlights from the day's play at the Oval.
Blitzing of England's bowlers at the Oval yesterday was one of the outstanding highlights of a wonderful summer. A great batsman. And his innings yesterday has given the West Indies a genuine chance of pressing on for victory over the final 2 days of the game. Richie Richardson batted very well. He was still there at the close and, I imagine, was a very happy man after all the recent pressure concerning the West Indian captaincy. Well, welcome to the highlights of the fourth day's play of this final Test match, the Cornhill Test at the Oval. Test series containing six such games, and we've had some wonderful play, not least yesterday with that 179 from Lara. That shows up on the scorecard of the West Indies side as they start the fourth day, 424 for 4, 179 for Lara. Caught Fraser, bowled Malcolm. Richardson, 87 not out, and a good innings too from Sherwin Campbell. Kenny Benjamin, the night watchman, did a good job. Bowling figures, well, they're reflected in the batting as well. A lot of runs made yesterday at a very, very brisk rate. Malcolm, 2 for 95. He dropped Hooper off his own bowling. They'll regret that, I reckon. And a wicket for Fraser and one for Cork. And the state of the game, England 454, West Indies 424 for 4, and the West Indies 30 runs behind. Well, the pitch has been very good so far. Here's Geoffrey Boycott's report on today.
Fourth morning at the Oval. Just have a look first on this very good pitch where Dominic Cork has been sticking his big feet and the umpires have been getting a little bit cross. This is about middle stump to middle stump. He's not supposed to have stud marks here. And that's why he's been warned twice by the neutral Indian umpire. There are the stud marks, clear as a bell, That's about middle stump, middle to middle. And he's on the danger area. He's got to keep off 12 inches from that. If we move down the pitch, it's not really changed at all. It's just getting drier and drier, more straw-coloured. And as that happens in this heat and sun and the little bit of wind, you might get an odd little mark like that. It's so dry that the top's gone. But that's about the only place I can find on this pitch that's got any sort of damage. We move down a bit further on the length. You see here, still flat, dry, red ball marks have made no impression on it. And this is still a very good flat batting pitch as any of the bowlers.
Well, I know one or two over the wrist spinners who wouldn't mind having a go there, but that's another story. We're going to join play now on this fourth day with the second ball of the first over. Angus Fraser is the bowler. Carl Hooper is taking strike. Sweetly timed. That's a good start for Richie Richardson. Loose delivery. Banged away down to fine leg.
Yes, I'm not sure he got this fully where he wanted it, but it doesn't matter really. You get some bat on it and it goes quickly down that pavilion end.
Brilliant catch. Richie Richardson gone for 93 to one of the most brilliant catches you'll see. Came right off the meat of the bat, and the fielder Graham Hick had to go to his left, and he has taken a blinder.
Well, it really was a ball that wanted hitting. It's halfway down the pitch. Right in the slot for Richie Richardson, his famous back foot slash. But he's got to miss the man, especially if he's a brilliant catcher like Graham Hick. Bit of disappointment there for Richie Richardson. You can tell from his body language, he couldn't believe that catch came off the middle of the bat. That brings in the new batsman, SHIVNARINE CHANDERPAUL.
It's a very good start for both Cork and Atherton. Oh, that's worth asking. It was very well bowled. He's got himself just outside off stump, but the big question is, was he playing a stroke? Ooh. Well, there's movement after the ball struck him. That was beautifully bowled by Dominic Cork.
Just giving him a nice juicy ball on his legs, but the batsman who's just come in, he's tucked it away very, very comfortably. That says a lot about the pitch, just eased onto the front foot. But what I do admire about Chanderpaul is the way he actually does throw his weight right over the ball. He gets the movement right into the line. Well, that's an easy four runs from no great shot. Little chop. No third man down there. Do you remember how this game started when he saw the ball fly off the edge between two stationary slips? Take a look at this. Well, he was taking his bat away. He was going to play it, and then he sort of half wasn't going to play it, but it was too late. It had nicked and gone, and both slips were asleep. Beautifully bowled. Well, the idea of fielding first and second slip is that you actually are certain that there is not the gap between Thorpe standing back, Graham Thorpe at second slip closer, and all the angles should be covered there. Russell, Thorpe and Hick. Well, that's another sign of a loss of concentration. Now, all this is not much fun for the fast bowler. That finds the gap. Terrific effort. But where's the ball gone now? I've been joined by Colin Croft, who I hope can add up. How many did they run then?
Good morning, Tony. I think that's five. Good effort. Saving one, giving away two.
This is the throw that suddenly set off in a very strange direction.
In the meantime, we have changes here since the umpire is now signaling four. So we subtract one from five. Well, actually, I think the ball did not hit the rope, but watch Mike Catterton's feet when he's picking the ball up. He is over the rope, which suggests it would be four runs.
And that's a brilliant catch. He dropped it. It looked as he brought his hands up, it looked as if it went in.
This is going down, but it did carry. Difficult catch, but it did carry and fall to the man at just about second slip. Hard catch, but catchable.
Oh. Well, that hit Carl Hooper on the head. He says he's all right straight away, so the helmet's done his job.
Well, this is as good a bounce as you could get. Short, fast, and straight. It hit, I think, just on the middle of that piece of tape that Carl Hooper has protecting the emblem.
Dismissed with contempt. Carl Hooper in form has so much time to play his shots. And on a pitch like this, that sort of length from Angus Fraser is going to go a long way.
It's a partnership between SHIVNARINE, CHANDERPAUL and Carl Hooper. Just taking 81 balls.
And Mike Watkinson is about to come into the attack at the pavilion end. Instant response from Carl Hooper. Dragged it from well wide of off stump. Carl Hooper, a murderous player of spinners. And not waiting to take the attack to Mike Watkinson. Beautifully played. Angus Fraser over-pitching, Carl Hooper taking full advantage, and the West Indies moving on past the 500 mark.
Well, they're asking whether or not he got back. Jack Russell doesn't think he did.
It was very wide. Russell had a long way to go after he took it. Chanderpaul was very, very quick to get back towards the batting crease. Safe as bungalows.
I think it's a dangerous move for the left-hander Chanderpaul to be dancing down the pitch. It's all right for the right-handers, but to Watkinson's bowling around the wicket into that bowler's rough, and the ball could jump and turn as we saw in the previous delivery.
Fine stroke. Placed that sweep very well. Yesterday we saw Lara placing the ball with his sweep when they moved the fielder fine. He swept it wider. And Chanderpaul also plays the stroke very well.
...50 for Carl Hooper. ...109 balls it's taken him. Not without the odd slice of luck. A fine shot. Mike Watkinson dropping too short, and interestingly enough, without any cover beyond that inner ring. Once the ball was through, it was always going to go for four. That's a fine shot. That's given no one any chance of cutting it off. Dramatic fashion to bring up the 100 partnership between Carl Hooper and SHIVNARINE Chanderpaul. And 50 for SHIVNARINE Chanderpaul now, following quickly in the footsteps of Carl Hooper. Very steady, very confident batting by this young man from Guyana.
The applause is for the throw, but it's all very composed. Batting now. 550 comes up, 5 wickets down. I think he was absolutely certain about that. Full toss, hammered away through mid-wicket.
Something of a cross bat here outside of stump. But sitting here in full and short of it, safe enough of a mid-wicket for four.
A big shout for LBW. Wow, he says.
Don't think the umpire would have given this. Carl Hooper was actually playing a shot. It did hit the pad and then the bat. Shot is being played at.
Cracking shot. Very physical response from Carl Hooper. What a magnificent straight six. There's so much elegance about it, and yet it was quite brutal.
Well, that was a cracking shot. Really plays that well with a quick turn of the wrists. Really middle that. With a great deal of zest and enthusiasm. Really, it's one leg side, one offside, one short. Most delicate shot. Using the pace of the ball. Runs everywhere, just two fielders in, saving the one. And the scoreboard tells its own story. 600 up, Carl Hooper moves on to 95. That's a beautiful stroke. Just great footwork. Century for Carl Hooper. His fifth in Test match cricket. Made one against India in his second Test. Then he's made two against Pakistan and one previously against England at Lord's.
With a slightly awkward bouncing ball. Nonetheless, one would have had to back him to do it. Certain parts of this outfield looking very rough, but a pretty basic error. Oh, he's lofted that many, many miles in the air. That's gone a long way back. That might have attracted the interest of Nasser on the way down, if not on the way up. Safely re-entered the Oval's atmosphere, this one, but it went a long way up. That's out, straight into the midriff. Easily caught by Jason Gallion. And Shivnarine Chanderpaul's dream of a Test match 100 yet to come true. Out for 80, it's been a very fine innings. Yet another West Indies batsman taking advantage of these very fine batting conditions, but just leaning a little bit back on that. Hit it on the up. Hit it pretty cleanly nonetheless. And unfortunately for Chanderpaul, straight at Jason Gallion at extra cover. New man, Courtney Brown. Hooper is still there, not out, 116. And Courtney Brown's immediate task is to try and keep this momentum going. There's another great shot, straight down the ground. Hooper now treating Devon Malcolm as a medium pacer.
Well, Carl Hooper started that shot with 116. That was a half volley, just about middle stump.
It's highly optimistic considering our current drought conditions. Straight up in the air, but safe. Unlucky, Dev. Did well to reach that.
I think Kyle Hooper here is trying to make sure that the lead is 200 when tee is taken.
Has he got him? Yes, Jet Russell's clutching the ball. Carl Hooper walking, I assume. Although Carl Hooper has now stopped himself in his tracks. Umpire Ramaswamy hasn't given him out as such, so if I were Carl Hooper, I'd just stand there, check on the decision. In fact, out of shot, umpire David Shepherd has confirmed the scoreboard. But indeed, Carl Hooper's innings is over. Caught by Jack Russell off the bowling of Devon Malcolm for 127. That's 126 runs later after Devon Malcolm had put down a very simple court and bowl chance last night. And it's been wonderful entertainment. Carl Hooper at his best. He's played some glorious shots. Some wonderful striking of a cricket ball. Here's another look from behind the bowler's arm. Clear edge and a very good catch from Jack Russell. Just carrying through to him. No, should have been no real doubt about that.
Very, very severely.
Well, I did say I thought all the tail-enders will have a go at anything short. They've nothing to lose. They're after quick runs. They can play and not worry about getting out. And that's a fine blow.
That's a good shot. Every so often, Dominic Cork will drift onto the batsman's pads, and these West Indian players are very, very strong men. That's a big one. It's been always like to test the bowlers out, the same way as the bowlers like to run their own little examination rule. That's a good shot. Certainly bat this fellow, Courtney Brown. Would have been gone for all money had it hit.
Well, Ian Bishop's a big fella. Once you start him running, the call was on you, see, once you start him running, he has to turn round. It's not so easy, it's like a Sherman tank turning.
That's a big shout there. And this could be a run out, and it's an easy run out. Well, it'd be very interesting to know what was going through Ian Bishop's mind there. Now then, Geoffrey, how did you read that?
Well, he nearly got run out the previous over, and he just whacks at this, as they have been doing in the last half an hour. They've been whacking at everything. He sees it run away, and he just sets off. But I forgot about his partner, and his partner didn't really bother to run. I think there was a run there if they'd have both gone straight away.
Kirkley Ambrose. It's been an exhausting day out there for England, and there's the evidence. No touch of the Sunday school outing about that. It actually beats their highest against England at the Oval, West Indies. They put up 6-8, 7-4, 8 back in 1976.
Three more runs added to take the West Indies declaration score along to 692-8. That was a great performance. They didn't just grind their way there. They thrashed England yesterday, kept it up today. The run rate was magnificent, and spectators and television viewers were treated to a feast of batting, some glorious strokes. Lowry yesterday won 79. Today, Richardson out for 93 fairly quickly. Then that splendid partnership between Hooper and Chanderpaul. Hooper 127, Chanderpaul 80. Needs to be kept in perspective because England weren't setting attacking fields. They were also looking for the declaration, but it was a very, very good piece of batting from those two. And then Courtney Brown, a bit of time for Courtney Brown as a cricketer, and I thought he batted well out there today for 27, and Bishop was run out for 10. 32 extras, and the partnerships, magnificent. Yesterday, Lara Richardson, and today, Hooper Chanderpaul, 196, and then two little partnerships at the end, 22 and 33. Well, you wouldn't expect the bowling figures to be anything to write home about, nor are they. Malcolm, 3 wickets, bowled well at times and in a bit of disarray at others. Fraser, 1 for 155, and Cork, 3 for 145, and the other three, Watkinson, Gallion and Hick, failed to take a wicket. That's the way it looked at the end of the West Indies innings. England 238 runs behind, and we join the England innings now in the first over. It's the third ball. Courtney Walsh is the bowler. Jason Gallion taking strike.
Great cheer goes up, and the young man is off the mark. First hurdle.
Well, there was a half shout here of catch. Bounced and landed well wide of the man of third slip.
Oh, an appeal. It came off something, but this time off his chest. He's been really vulnerable against the rising ball, as Jason Gallion.
The position of the bat here is interesting. He's dropped his shoulder, his hands, and the ball just clips his shoulder, I think.
Four runs. Come to expect that sort of stroke from Michael Atherton. Right on top of the bounce. A straight bat, but the ball angled out square on the offside. And the skipper's off the mark. It'll be a long chase. I doubt if they'll make it. And suddenly the ball slows up, but not that slow. Just a firm push to mid on. There was no one fielding there. Two fours in succession for Mike Atherton.
That's well bowled. Right up in the slot.
In the first innings, Courtney Walsh have a loud shout against Jason Gallion also. perhaps might have been missing leg stump, since the middle and off stump were very visible when that appeal was made.
That's going to race away for four.
Yes, Kirtley Ambrose's direction has not been good in these few of his so far.
Nicely struck. Ian Bishop giving chase. And he can pull that off now. Both these batsmen have found that deep wicket boundary, that wide long on boundary from Courtney Walsh.
Nice juicy full toss just on the pads, just using the pace of the ball to just guide it through the spaces.
Oh, I just have jumped himself into trouble there.
Probably they're going to be jumping for a while.
There's a ray of something bright. Which one is the real one?
Beautifully bowled.
Well, he almost got him. Just seemed to leave the batsman off the pitch and then went a long way after it got past the bat.
He's passed him on either side of the bat now, one with a very good leg cutter, and the other one which looked from here as though it came back between bat and pad. Nope, still on the outside, but very game leave there. Advantage of the one pitched round about his pads. The end of Bishop's over. Neatly played away by Gallien. Three more runs added to take England along to 39 for no wicket at the close of the fourth day of this Cornhill Test match. Gallien 22, Atherton 17. Gallien did well. It's no easy task to go out there when you're on a pair and bat with the comfort he did. Atherton was there at the end, as he has been all along for England this series, and 39 on the board for England. Now the bowling figures, no wickets taken there. Chanderpaul and Hooper bowled. Hooper the off spinner. Chanderpaul, the leg spinner, bowled for the first time in the series, four overs, no maiden, and no wicket for five. And the reason they were brought on was that Richie Richardson realised the umpires would offer the light to the batsman if the quick bowler stayed on. He whipped his spinners on very quickly. One of the strange sights I've ever seen in Test match cricket, or any other cricket for that matter, is that before Chanderpaul started to bowl, he put on a pair of shin pads, which could have all sorts of meanings, I suppose. May have had an experience with the batsman driving back at him very, very fast. Four overs for five for him. And the state of the match at the conclusion of this fourth day. England, having got through to 39 for no wicket, are 199 runs behind. It's a very good match, has been all the way through, as indeed has been the series. And here's Geoffrey Boycott now with his ideas on the day.
Well, another terrific day's cricket with the West Indies batsmen on top. It was the big stand between Hooper and Chanderpaul that put the England bowlers to the sword. Hooper, calm, elegant, classical. Chanderpaul, a young man making his way, doesn't look quite as classical as Hooper, but very effective young man that should have a great test career. The England bowlers, they stuck at it hard. It was the ground fielding that impressed me. Two hard days in the field, they stuck at it very well, the England fielders. But if they'd have caught the catches, they could have saved themselves a lot of grief. Chanderpaul and Hooper were both dropped early on. One was difficult, one was straightforward. Tomorrow, what will happen? Well, everybody says it'll be a draw. But if West Indies get early wickets, England know they could slide to defeat. I fancy a draw, though. The pitch has taken the sting out of all the bowlers, and the pitch has won in the end. But you never can tell with these West Indies fast bowlers.
Thanks, Geoffrey. Geoffrey Boycott with his ideas on what has happened throughout the 4 days of this match and what might happen on the fifth day. We'll be there with BBC One at 10:50 in the morning, and the abiding memory today will be of Carl Hooper and that brilliant century.
By rights, ex-commando Sergeant Reggie Perrin shouldn't be alive.